Hello. So today we are going to talk about likability, the X factor. How do you get someone to like you? How is it that some people are drawn to others? How is it that when we meet some people, we just don't want to talk to them at all? Yeah, we are naturally drawn to some people and we shy away from some people. Obviously, if I am to help you, you should like me and I should like you. If I am to serve you, you should like me and I should like you. Well, the service will become better, isn't it? And if I am to get something useful from you, you should like me and I should like you. So the likability factor becomes extremely important. We really can't survive in this world if we don't like each other. So what's the opposite of liking each other? Hating each other or being scared of each other? Well, that's not going to really work. If I am to help you, if I am to serve you, if I am to get something from you, if you are to help me, we need to have this likability factor. Like I tell lots of people when we do a program on interviewing skills, how to get and keep the job that you really love, the job of your dreams. See, isn't it true that ultimately the only reason that someone got employed into an organization is that the person who was doing the interview liked the applicant and the applicant liked the person who was doing the interview. So there was a human connection that was formed. There was a human bond that was formed. Likability, extremely important. And it's actually necessary for us to survive and thrive in this world. How do I like you? How do you like me? How do I get you to like me? How can you get me to like you? And it's very important. Once we like each other, we can do lots of things together. So the X factor, likability. How do we trigger it in others? That's what we're going to talk about today. And I hope this is really exciting. And I hope you want to watch the whole thing, because right through we'll be talking about tips and tricks, how to get people, how to build rapport with people, how to get people to like us, and how to build friendships with people. So one of the words that comes up when we talk about likability is this thing called charisma. Charisma. We say, oh, wow, he was a very charismatic person. People just naturally loved him. They liked him. He had such a magnetic personality. What is charisma? We say that John F. Kennedy had charisma. We say that Hitler had charisma. So charisma doesn't mean that you have to be a good person, but it's that you have warmth and that people actually like you. They are drawn towards you. So charismatic people, how do we become a charismatic person? Lord, for many years, people thought that charisma was something you were born with. Either you had it, if you didn't have it, you were not born with it, well, you couldn't develop charisma. But now we know that to be wrong. And personally, I know that to be wrong as well. Because once I got to know, okay, how do you do this? I have been actually practicing it more in my seminars, in my meetings. And I find, yeah, it works. It works. Let's discover what charisma is first, and then how do we switch it on. Joe Girard has got many awards for being the world's best salesman, and he has been doing this for many years. And Joe Girard says, you know, one of the things that I did to build rapport with my clients, to get sales from them for so many years, was very simple. What did I do? I just showed them that I liked them. I didn't say, okay, you like me. No, I showed them that I liked them. So he would send his clients a note once every month or so saying, I'm just thinking about you. How are things in your life? I wish you well. I like you. Great. Would anyone get upset if they get an SMS from someone or they get a WhatsApp from someone in the morning saying, hi, good morning. I was just thinking about you. I hope you have an awesome day. Sounds great, isn't it? We love it when we feel that others are thinking about us. We love it when we feel that others care about us. So this is something that Joe Girard did. Something else. There was a study done to try to find who were the most popular teenagers in high schools and what made these guys popular. And when you ask this question, you would think that normally the most popular people in the high school or in secondary schools, high school or secondary school, would be the sportsmen, would be the cricketers, would be the rugby players, would be the kids who are involved in theater, in drama, in music. But when they actually studied this, they found this was not the case. Who were the kids who were liked the most? Surprise, surprise. The kids who were liked the most were the kids who knew the most other children. Let's say if I only knew 5 people by name and my friend Sam knew 100 people by name who he would greet as he walks into the school, he would see these 100 kids, he would talk to them, he would say, good morning Peter, good morning John, good morning Sam, good morning Sanath, good morning Rohan. What happens? John and Peter and Sam and Rohan and Sanath all now immediately like my friend, because he showed that he likes them first by getting to know them, by acknowledging them, by speaking to them. So the most popular kids were the kids who knew the most number of other people and who actually interacted with them, who engaged with them, who spoke to them by name. So it wasn't really the sportsman or the rugby players. Well, it could be a sportsman if that particular sportsman knew others as well. So just imagine walking down the corridor and engaging, talking to everyone that you see. Hi, Sam, how are you? Hi, Susan, that's a lovely kit that you're wearing. Hi, Peter, you're looking great today. So, likability. If we want others to like us, where does it start? We have to show others that we like them first. And of course, genuinely. Every single thing has to be done genuinely. It can't be fake. Right? People pick up on fake very, very fast now. And it really doesn't help, isn't it? Being fake doesn't give us a sense of pride, doesn't give us a sense of accomplishment, or doesn't give us a sense of satisfaction either. Genuine. Being genuine. Genuinely liking others. And that's what I do at every single training program that I conduct. Even before the program starts, I make it a point, I go up to people, go up to the participants, talk to them, get to know them, appreciate them for being here, for being at the program. And when we start the program, I have already built a rapport with my audience. I've already built a rapport with the participants. There's already likability between us. Not only that they like me, but I like them as well. And guess where it starts again? With me liking them. And every human being wants to be liked. So if you go out and show people you like them, well, it's going to be reciprocal. They're going to like you back in return. So that's the first magic factor. If you want others to like you, like them first. So when we meet someone for the first time, do we want to pull them towards us or do we want to push them away? And this is coming from the magic factor of charisma. And what happens in those first few seconds? How do we create a great first impression? There are some people, as soon as we see them, we feel drawn towards them. We want to talk to them. We wish that they spoke with us. Those are the people with so-called charisma. So what is charisma and how do we develop it in us? Charisma is said to be made up of two factors: how warm you are and how competent you are. How warm you are is how much do people feel that they can get close to you, that you're not going to turn them away, that people love you. How warm you are and how competent you are is, do you know what to say that you know? Can you help them in some way? Are you competent? So how warm we are and how confident we are is basically the two factors that make up charisma. So charisma is how attractive we are, the charm that we have, the magnetic presence that we have. All of this together is charisma. So how do we build this? Charisma makes people naturally drawn to each other, which often leads to influence and admiration. So it's very important that we have a balance between warmth and confidence. Warmth and confidence or competence. So why are we interested in whether somebody is competent or not? Because we can see that person is confident. And if someone is confident, it's highly likely that they're also competent. But if someone is so confident, so competent, that we feel, my gosh, it's too much. In the sense, this person is so knowledgeable, so clever, that there is no way that he is going to like us. Then we are going to still shy away. And there are people like that as well. We don't want to talk to them because we feel that we are so much less than them. They are so much more than us. They know so much more than us that we don't want to really talk to them. It's like you join an organization as a junior executive. We are not going to really want to talk to the chairman of the organization. unless the chairman is such a warm person that he comes and talks to us. Otherwise, we won't approach, because we feel, my gosh, there's too much of a gap between where we are and where the chairman of this organization is. So competence without warmth is not going to get charisma, right? Because we won't talk to these people, we want to keep them aside because we feel they're too much away from us. There's too much of a gap between us. Warmth without competence means everyone likes us. Everyone might invite us for a party or something, people like us, but we won't be taken seriously. This person is very warm, a very nice person. People might get us to do various things to help them because they won't be scared at all to approach us and ask for help because we are so warm. But if you have an idea, it's not taken seriously because the people feel we are very warm, yes, we are very likable, yes, but we don't really have this charisma. We don't have competence. We don't have confidence. Therefore, if I want something from someone else, they won't give it to me. I want someone to do something for me, they won't do it because they don't feel that I really matter or I really count. So very nice person. I'm a very nice person. Everyone likes me, but I'm not taken seriously. So you see, it's very important that we have a balance between warmth and competence. We need to have them both in equal measure. Then we have charisma. So it's very easy, really. How do we switch on confidence, which we will talk about when we talk of how do you switch on a great first impression? And of course, warmth. Warmth comes from inside. Do I like you? And if I show you that I like you, you're going to like me back in return. So how do we actually generate warmth as well? Also part of what we'll discuss under a great in first impression. So don't go away. So when we talk of warmth and competence, why this matters so much in charisma is when we meet someone, we are immediately trying to answer two questions. The first one, can I trust you? Do I like you? And the second, can I rely on you? Do I trust you? Warmth. Can I rely on you? Competence. So that's why warmth and competence are important, because we're asking these two questions. Building on what we said about likability, you will like me if I like you first. People like people who like them. And people like people who are like them. We like people who seem like us. We like people who have the same interests as us. So you meet someone at a cocktail, you get talking, and you realize, my gosh, this guy really loves cricket. And you realize you love cricket as well. Ah, there's immediately a rapport formed. When you're talking to someone and realize that person loves cricket, let's say you are not really passionate about cricket, but you do know something about cricket. You watch the match that was on last night. You can talk about that match, and immediately you talk about the match, what happens? You create rapport because you're talking about something which is a common interest. You're not as passionate as the other guy, but you know enough about cricket. Talk about it with him and therefore create a bond. See, when we get into conversation, we can always find things of commonality. We can always find things which are similar, same between us. So people like people who are like us. Let's say you talk to someone and you realize he's from Kandy, right? Well, you are not from Kandy, you're from Colombo. You have never lived in Kandy before, but you know some friends in Kandy. You know some schools in Kandy. So you can immediately ask him, did you go to this school? Because I have some friends there. Although he may have not gone to that school, talking about a school in Kandy, because he's also from Kandy, immediately now creates a bond. Because we're talking about something that he also knows about and something that we also know about. A topic which is common. So recently I met someone from Kandy and we were talking, and I realized this person actually has been living in Kandy for many, many years of their life. And immediately I started talking about the fact that for a very short time, about a month or two, I was training the choir of Hillwood College, Kandy, a girls' school in Kandy. I didn't do it for very long, but talking about the fact that I did it and that I used to come up to Kandy once a month created a bond between us. So there was something common to talk about. So that's how you build rapport. So coming back to our really the magic sentence or the magic statement, people like people who like them and people like people who are like them. So we like people who like us and we like people who are like us. So like us and like us. That sounds a little strange, but it's true, isn't it? I like you if you like me, and I like you if you are like me. So when we talk of first impressions, today they say that A first impression is created between 2 to 7 seconds of meeting someone or 2 to 7 seconds of seeing someone. And that's a very, very short time, isn't it? One of the studies that was done, so this was based on a study done by Nalini Ambadi and Robert Rosenthal of Harvard, where the students were shown muted videos of the professors teaching for 10 seconds, for 5 seconds, and for 2 seconds, and they were measured on 15 dimensions of effectiveness, including warmth, optimism, and professionalism. It was on students in a university where they were asked to rate professors on how competent, how knowledgeable, how friendly that they were. And students were given, just shown a small video clip of 10 seconds and asked to rate these professors on these qualities. They couldn't hear them, they could only see what they were doing. They could see the body language, but they couldn't hear any sound. And what they found was, when the professors were rated with a 10 second video, whom the students said they liked and whom they disliked was the same as when students rated people, the same people, watching a 5 second video. And it was the same when they watched just a 2 second video. So what did this show? That when someone saw the professor teaching for 2 seconds or 5 seconds or 10 seconds, broadly, the results were quite similar, which is like most of the people said that they liked a particular professor. Most of the people said they disliked a particular professor, didn't think he was competent, didn't think he was, you know, professional in how he taught. Yeah, didn't think that he was warm. And surprise, surprise, when this was matched with the evaluations given by students who had actually sat through the entire semester of these professors teaching, they were physically present in their classroom, not watching a video, who had listened to the professor for the whole semester, gave them the evaluation, the evaluations were the same. Isn't this fantastic? The first impression that was created in just 2 seconds or 5 seconds or 10 seconds was the same as the results or the evaluation done on the professors by students who had sat through the entire class, the entire semester. So what does this show? That first impressions are created really, really fast. This generally matches with what people really think about them as well. And it's very difficult to change first impression. Not impossible, but very, very difficult. It's uphill. So when we meet someone for the first time, we're asking 3 questions in our mind. The first is, are you a friend or a foe? Now this question is very important because it is, if you're a friend, I don't think you're going to hurt me. If you're a foe, I don't want to approach you because I feel you could be a threat to my personal safety. So do I trust you? Do I feel safe with you? So friend or foe? First question. And obviously, if I feel you're a foe, well, that's the end of the story because I'm not going to approach you. I'm going to, you know, walk away. Why would I want to approach someone from whom I feel there can be physical danger? I feel that you could actually hurt me. No, I don't want to talk to you. Right? So first question, are you a friend or a foe? And it's very important that we show people that we are a friend and not a foe. How do we do this? One thing, open hands. Even when we are walking in, yeah, when we are walking in with our hands open and it's warm, soft hands, it shows people, it seems that, you know, Sanjeev is a nice, warm person. I don't have to be scared because I can see that there is no weapon in his hands. Now, this is why it's coming. It's coming from many, many thousands of years of evolution. If I didn't see someone's hands, I couldn't see the hands, it could be that I had a knife or I had a weapon in my hands, right? So if you can't see my hands, you're going to have a question subconsciously. I don't see Sanjeev's hands. So could there be a threat there? Could there be a physical threat? So one way that I can show you, look, I am not a physical threat to you, is show you my open hands. And even when we shake hands with someone, originally that was the reason that someone shook hands. Right now we shake hands palm to palm, isn't it? But in the olden days, you would shake someone's hand, not by the palm, but you would grasp the forearm. Why is that? Because that's a check to see, is there a weapon hidden under his toga? So the Romans used to carry weapons hidden under the toga. So by grasping someone's forearm, you could immediately see, is there a weapon or not? And I would see, grasp somebody else's forearm, there is no weapon. All right, good, I can trust you. Let's move on. Let's have a conversation now. So there is always a reason for these customs as well. So how do I disarm you in the sense that how do I show you I'm not a threat, I'm not a physical threat? One is showing my open hands. Number two, smiling. And when it's a genuine smile, we know this person is friendly. We know this person is friendly. And there are some people I know who are smiling all the time. And they're so warm, so warm. Where does the smile start? People would say it starts from the lips. No, the smile starts from the intention, from the mind. If we want people to like us, and we actually like more people, we like to be with people, we like people, the smile is going to just switch on and it's going to be genuine. This is not a genuine smile, because the smile doesn't reach the eyes. This is, because you can see it's reaching the eyes now. It's reaching the eyes. And why am I happy? Because I'm genuinely happy to see you there. I'm genuinely happy that you're watching this video. So a genuine smile starts from the intention, from the thought. And then that intention is going to be reflected in our body language. So two things we can do to disarm someone. Show him I'm a friend, not a foe. I'm not there to hurt you. Smiling and, you know, open hands. The second question that we are asking in our mind when we see someone is, are you a winner or a loser? If you're a loser, yes, I don't feel a physical threat from you. Yes, I know you're not going to hurt me. Yes, my life is not in danger, but why should I waste time with you? Because obviously you cannot be of assistance to me. You're a loser. You don't have much knowledge. You haven't really, you know, you're not showing confidence in yourself. You're not showing competence. So are you competent? Are you confident? These are the questions which are leading me to come to the conclusion of someone being a winner or a loser. Is someone interesting? Are you a leader? If you're a leader, wow, you could be a winner. It's someone that I could, you know, I should get to know, because you can be of assistance to me in some way. We're always trying to ask that question, isn't it? Are you a threat? Could you be of help? Could you be of assistance? You're not a threat? Okay, that's fine. Could you be of assistance? No. All right. Why don't I talk to someone who could be of assistance? Because that's human nature, isn't it? We're always trying to answer these questions. How do you show that you are confident? The way you walk, the way you even sit. So if you hold your back up straight, yeah, your chin is up. As soon as you put your chin up and you put your shoulders back, what happens? Your chest comes forward and we immediately feel more confident. And people, when they see us, they feel that we are more confident. And the way we walk. They say that if we can increase the speed of walking by about 25%, it immediately makes us more confident, we feel more confident, and people who watch us think that we are more confident as well. So one way that we can immediately show people we are confident and therefore we are competent, the way we walk, the way we hold ourselves, shoulders not hunched but straight, not military straight, not like being in the army or something, something like that, but just, you know, holding yourself upright. Holding yourself upright. And the third question that we're asking in our mind when we see someone is, are you an ally or are you an enemy? An ally is, are you someone that I could possibly partner with? Are you someone I could collaborate with? Are you someone who can help me? So are you an ally or are you an enemy? You're competent, yes. You're very confident, yes. I don't think you will physically harm me, yes. But I don't want to give you my ideas because I feel you might take them and, you know, do something on your own and leave me out. So do I trust you again there? Are you an ally? Can I work with you? Right? Can we collaborate? Can we team up? So today, in today's world, collaboration is so important, isn't it? We can't really compete with everyone. We need to collaborate. Even there was a time, even Microsoft and IBM, traditional enemies, were actually collaborating, working on some projects together, because we find that today, the more we collaborate, the more everyone wins. So collaboration. Are you someone I can collaborate with? And that's the third question. Are you an ally or an enemy? So the three questions we ask in our mind when we meet someone. First one, are you a friend or foe? Are you there to hurt me? The second question, are you a winner or a loser? And the third question, are you an ally or an enemy? So when we continue more about first impressions, we were talking about certain things already. Eye contact. Right, smiling, yes, we discussed. As soon as you smile, a hormone called oxytocin is created in your brain, which helps you to feel more relaxed, helps you to feel friendlier. And when others see you, they feel that you are close to them as well. They feel that you're a friendly person as well. So oxytocin is also called the love hormone, and it's going to come up in some of the other points as well. Making eye contact. Now see, I'm trying to make eye contact with you. I'm sure you feel that I am looking at you, that I'm making eye contact with you. When we make eye contact with someone, again, we increase the production of oxytocin, both in ourselves and in the other person. The posture, yeah, we discuss posture, how you walk, how you stand, creates oxytocin as well. And open hands creates oxytocin as well. So oxytocin is called the love hormone. Oxytocin is naturally generated when you're with a group of friends, you're with family, you're having a good time, you're feeling safe, you're secure, you can let your guard down, you can be yourself. That's when oxytocin is produced. And oxytocin helps us to feel that way. So if we want others to feel safe in our presence, or we want them to feel comfortable, secure, which means that they would open up and talk to us, we need to help generate oxytocin in them. How do we do this? Smiling, eye contact, open hands, and the handshake. All of that actually increases oxytocin. When we talk of shaking hands, it's very important that we do this right. It should be a vertical handshake like that, which means that I respect you, but I'm not giving my power to you, neither do I feel that you have more power over me. If I want to show someone I'm being very submissive, well, I would shake hands like that. So he would put his hand, I would allow this person to put his hand on top of me. We see that people who want to show power, want to show domination, would put their hand on top of the other person. Not a vertical handshake, that, but they'll shake hands like that. So please don't do this with your boss or someone who is actually above you, because that person is going to feel extremely annoyed that you're trying to take his power away from him. So ideally, vertical handshake. Both are equal. But if you want to give the power to someone else, it could be a client, it could be a boss, show them. Doesn't matter, you have the power, and I acknowledge that. Well, we could turn our hand slightly this way so that he or she can keep their hand on top of us. So that's the first tip. Don't give a limp handshake like this. Say somebody just give their hand like that and other person has to grasp it. That's called the dead fish handshake. It doesn't help anyone. You feel horrible. So what's a great handshake? Squeeze the other person's hand until you can feel the tension or the muscles of that person's hand. So keep squeezing until you can feel that. It doesn't mean that you squeeze so hard that person, you know, you hurt the person, and the person is, ow, it really hurt me. No, but squeeze until you feel the muscles or the tension in the other person's hand, right? Until you feel some tension. Another example is, imagine squeezing an orange to see if the orange is ripe enough to eat. So you keep squeezing until you can feel, right, whether there is tension or not. That's the same way that we need to squeeze the hand of another person as well. So firm handshake. So when you squeeze till you can feel the muscles, that means the other person can feel your hand as well. Don't kill the person. Don't squeeze so hard it hurts. It's important that we actually have dry hands when we are shaking hands. So if you're someone who sweats, there you have sweaty palms, just carry a handkerchief or a piece of cloth, especially before walking into a forum where you're going to shake so many people's hands, you know, just dry your hands, because it's really unpleasant sometimes to have a moist palm. So just dry it off. I know some of us naturally have a sweaty palm. We can just dry it off. How long should we keep eye contact? Well, studies say, I'm talking, I maintain eye contact with you for 41% when I'm the speaker, and I maintain eye contact with you for about 75% of the time when I'm listening. So overall, about 60 to 70% of the time when you're talking with someone, we should maintain eye contact. But remember, it's not 100%, it's not all the time. So do look away from time to time, but maintain that eye contact for a long period as well. When it makes that person feel really valued, that you are listening, that you are giving that person attention, that you respect the person, all of this is coming with eye contact. And therefore, if someone doesn't make eye contact, so it's, I'm talking to you, but you're not looking somewhere, so I'm talking to you, but looking down, or I'm talking to you, but like that, right, or like that. You feel, okay, Sanjeev is not respecting me, Sanjeev doesn't trust me, or Sanjeev is hiding something. So it could be all of that. Of course, the way you dress is also very, 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 very important. Showing people that you are smart. So they say that clothes makes the man, and clothes makes the woman as well. Buy some great clothes so that when you wear them, you automatically feel more confident. So physical attractiveness is also an important point that we need to keep in mind when we are trying to increase the likability. A study done at the Canadian federal elections found that attractive candidates got more than 2.5 times the votes of candidates considered not as attractive. Yeah, so attractiveness, physical attraction does play a part. I know we can't all be like Hollywood handsome, right? But we can always look the best version of ourselves possible. We can always groom ourselves so that we look great. And everyone, when they smile, when anyone smiles, we immediately look that much nicer, isn't it? So smiling always helps to make us look more attractive. So grooming, is the hair combed? Are we dressed in good clothes, right? Good quality clothes. All of this actually helps address attractiveness, physical attractiveness. Another study showed that attractive candidates were twice as likely to avoid going to jail as unattractive candidates. So we find even juries are swayed by how attractive a person is. Another classic example or a great story was the 1960s presidential election debate in 1960s in the US between John F. Kennedy and Richard Nixon. So the first debate was on radio, and it says that Richard Nixon clearly won the debate. People felt that he had scored more points than Kennedy. But when it came to TV, which is where people could actually see the candidates, right, TV was quite new at that time. So Nixon wasn't comfortable on TV. He refused to have any makeup put on him, although the TV producer said, "Mr. Nixon, if you don't put makeup, you're going to, your face is going to look very shiny, plus you're going to be sweating a lot." And he said, no, I'm a man, men don't wear makeup. So he refused to wear makeup. And on TV, during the debate, he looked very sweaty. There was sweat pouring down his cheeks. He didn't look very comfortable at all. Whereas John F. Kennedy, when he was told by the producer, "Mr. Kennedy, can we put some makeup on you?" He said, "Make me as nice as you can." And it was very clear as to who won the television debate. According to the audience, it was John F. Kennedy, not Nixon. Look how good we look. Physical attractiveness plays a big part. So let's summarize some of the things that we have discussed. If we want to increase the X factor of likability, one of the key things we have to keep in mind is we like people who like us and who are like us. So I like you if you like me, and I like you if you are like me. So that's very important. Keep that in mind. So building similarity, building rapport, increases liking. And we can always do that. It's fairly easy. Start having a conversation with someone. You immediately find points of similarity. Things that you also like, or things that you know that someone else likes. For example, someone says, "I like spicy food." Well, you don't like spicy food, but you know your spouse likes spicy food. Well, you can bring that into the conversation. That's also a point of similarity. You at least know someone who likes spicy food, right? So you can talk about spicy food. Physical attraction, we spoke about. Having energy and vitality, very important. We don't want to, by choice, interact with someone who's visibly sick. Because why? We are in survival mode. We are thinking, okay, if I associate with someone who's visibly sick, I can get sick as well. So I don't want to get sick. So having energy, having vitality, the way we walk, the energy with which we talk, the energy with which we walk is also very, very important. Show energy. You can be a 20-year-old acting like you're 80 with the energy of an 80-year-old. And I have also known 70 and 80-year-olds who have more energy than normal 20 to 25-year-olds. So it's not age, it's just mindset, how much of energy we actually have, how much of energy we portray, how much of energy we genuinely have in our lives, in our body. And that's very important. So energy becomes very important. Doesn't matter age, you have energy. People love compliments. People love to be appreciated. So if you appreciate someone, you give them a genuine compliment, well, likability is going to increase as well. Remember, can't be fake. And finally, people like people who are going to help them. We love people who are going to help us, isn't it? Because, again, we want people to help us. It's all built on survival. We cannot survive alone. We need to cooperate. We need to help others. We need others to help us. If we feel that someone is going to help us, well, obviously, we are going to like that person more. So, I hope you like this video about the likability factor. How do we switch on likability in ourselves so that others like us more, right? And therefore, life becomes so much more pleasant. We make more friends, yeah? We're able to get help from others when we need it, yeah? So likability factor, the X factor, the human X factor, extremely important. I hope you like this video. If you did, please don't forget to subscribe, because there'll be many more videos like this. And please comment about it. Tell us how you build your likability with others, or what has been the challenge in building likability with others. And I'll be more than happy to answer your comment and try to help you in some way. All right then, till the next video, stay safe and stay blessed. I'm Sanjeev.